एवरीवन, टॉपिक ऑफ टुडेज डिस्कशन इज हिस्टोलॉजी ऑफ कैरेटिनाइज म्यूकोसा। इन द अर्लियर डिस्कशन वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ ओरल म्यूकोसा दैट इट हैज बीन क्लासिफाइड बेस्ड ऑन द टाइप ऑफ एपिथेलियम, बेस्ड ऑन देयर फंक्शन एंड बेस्ड ऑन देयर हिस्टोलॉजी। सो टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग द हिस्टोलॉजी ऑफ कैरेटिनाइज म्यूकोसा। सो व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट द एपिथेलियम ऑफ द ओरल कैविटी, वी हैव टू कीप इन माइंड दैट इट इज द stratified squamous epithelium in the oral cavity. It can be keratinized, it can be non-keratinized. Based on the pattern of keratinization, it can be further subclassified into orthokeratinized and parakeratinized. Okay, so in the oral cavity, we'll be having stratified squamous epithelium, which can be keratinized or non-keratinized. In the keratinization, it can be orthokeratinized or it can be parakeratinized. So when we classify oral mucosa, it can be classified based on their functional adaptation. So the mucosa which will bear the masticatory forces will be masticatory mucosa, which comprises of gingiva and hard palate. The mucosa which lines the oral cavity and moistens it is the lining mucosa, and it comprises of soft palate, ventral surface of tongue, floor of mouth, alveolar mucosa, labial and buccal mucosa, and the fornix. Also, there is another kind of specialized mucosa which carries special sensation, and it comprises of dorsal surface of tongue. So when we see in the oral cavity, the majority of the oral cavity is lined by the lining mucosa, the hard palate and the gingiva is lined by the masticatory mucosa, and the dorsal surface of tongue is lined by the specialized mucosa. Oral mucosa is also classified based on their keratinization. It can be keratinized or non-keratinized. The masticatory mucosa, since it bears the masticatory load or the masticatory forces, so they become keratinized. So gingiva and hard palate will come under the keratinized mucosa. The other structures will fall into the category of non-keratinized mucosa. So based on the function, the masticatory mucosa is that component of mucosa which bears the forces which are being generated during the chewing movement. So this mucosa is directly adhered to the bone and it does not stretch. It is firm. So in the oral cavity, 25% of the area is bounded by masticatory mucosa and it has gingiva and hard palate. When we talk about the lining mucosa, it covers the entire oral cavity, the musculature. It is distensible, it is soft, and it provides contraction and relaxation of all the structures of the oral cavity, such as lip, buccal mucosa, alveolar mucosa, floor of the mouth, soft palate. So 60% of the area in the oral cavity is bounded by the lining mucosa. Then the third category of mucosa we have is the specialized mucosa. And this mucosa has a special function, that is for the detection of taste. And it is on the dorsum of the tongue and in the taste buds. So we have keratinized mucosa or the masticatory mucosa, which has gingiva and hard palate. Then we have lining mucosa, which covers the entire oral cavity and comprises of about 60%. The third category is the specialized mucosa, which is there in the tongue papillae and the taste bud. That is 15%. Now, when we talk about the types of keratinized epithelium, we have parakeratinized epithelium and orthokeratinized epithelium. When we talk about parakeratinized epithelium, we have to remember parakeratinized will have pycnotic nuclei. So P for parakeratinized, P for pycnotic. So you have to remember with this mnemonic that the superficial layer of the epithelium will become dead, but they retain their nucleus, that too in a shrunken or pycnotic form. Whereas orthokeratinized epithelium is categorized by the absence of nuclei. So in orthokeratinized epithelium, there is no nucleus in the superficial layer, whereas in parakeratinized, there will be a flat pycnotic nuclei. So when we talk about the histology of keratinized mucosa, there are four layers in the histology. The first layer is the basal layer, that is stratum basale, also known as stratum germinatum. This is the layer of proliferative pool. Maximum dividing activity takes place in this layer, followed by stratum spinosum, which is a spinous or prickle cell layer. And this is because of the stretching of the cell. Therefore, the intercellular bridges and the junctions appear prominent and the cell takes the shape of a spine or a prickle. That is why this layer is also known as stratum spinosum. Followed by which there is a layer stratum granulosum, which is categorized by the presence of granules. So keratohyaline granules are present in this layer, and the superficial layer is the stratum corneum, in which you will see the squames of the epithelial cells. These are the dead keratinocytes, in which you can appreciate either no nucleus if it is orthokeratinized and shrunken or pycnotic nuclei if it is parakeratinized. So we'll be discussing these four layers in detail about the histology of keratinized mucosa. So starting with this layer, stratum basale, this layer is also known as basal layer, and it comprises of cuboidal to columnar cells, and it is adjacent to the basement membrane. What is a basement membrane? Basement membrane is a structure which demarcates the epithelium from the connective tissue. So it is the epithelial connective tissue interface, and it is neither the part of epithelium nor the part of connective tissue. It is an extracellular matrix which is being derived from the components of epithelial and connective tissue. So the basal layer is connected to the connective tissue layer with the help of this basement membrane. This layer is also known as stratum germinativum. When we talk about these layers are formed by the cells that have the ability to undergo mitosis. So this layer will be in the dividing pool. It will synthesize DNA, and new cells are generated in the basal layer. So this is the dividing cell layer. This basal layer will be having two cell population. One is serrated, another is non-serrated. The serrated layer will be heavily packed with tonofilaments, and it will provide attachment in the form of desmosomes and hemidesmosomes. Okay. The other layer is non-serrated, which comprises of stem cells. These cells will be slow dividing, and they will protect the genetic information of the tissue that this cell has to differentiate into this structure, because the basal layer will differentiate into the spinous layer will differentiate into the granular layer, and then it will form stratum corneum and the cells will shed off. So this is the hierarchy which this strata will follow. So we have the basal layer, which is the dividing cell layer, in all the four layers. So this stratum basale is made up of the cells which synthesize DNA and undergoes mitosis. And since there is active protein synthesis in the layer, so there will be more number of ribosome, more number of rough endoplasmic reticulum, which indicates that synthetic activities are taking place in this basal layer. Now, when we talk about the basal layer, there is a structureless zone which is below this basal layer, that is known as basement membrane. We'll be discussing in detail about the basement membrane in further discussions. This is a layer which in the electron microscope can be visualized into two zones, that is the lamina lucida and the lamina densa. Lucida is the light zone which connects the epithelium to the basal lamina cells to the basement membrane. And the lamina densa is the dark zone which connects the basement membrane to the anchoring fibrils with the underlying connective tissue. So these are the basement membrane zone components, in which we have the basal lamina or the basal cell layer, then the lamina lucida, lamina densa, followed by anchoring fibrils. Now these basal cells are attached to the basal lamina with the help of hemidesmosomes, because these epithelial cells will have contact through the desmosomal and hemidesmosomal connections. So there are different tonofilaments and anchoring fibrils which provide attachment to this cell, basal layer cells, to the basement membrane. Now moving on to the next layer is the stratum spinosum. So above to the basal layer is the prickle cell layer, which is also known as stratum spinosum. And this prickle word is derived from the Greek word akanthe. Akanthe means prickle, spinous. So when the cells shrink away from each other and they make the contact only with the intercellular bridges, the desmosomal junctions, so they will attain a prickle-like profile. Let's say a spine hota hai, that kind of profile it will attain. Therefore, if there is increase in the thickness of spinous layer, we'll call it acanthosis. However, if there is separation of cells by the loss of these junctions, that term will be known as acantholysis. These two terms will help you in learning pathology. This is the basic terms which we'll be discussing when we'll be discussing the pathology of oral mucosa. Okay, So these are two terms. One is acanthosis, which means the increase in the thickness. One is acantholysis. Anything with the suffix lysis means breakdown. So the breakdown of this spinous layer is acantholysis. So when we talk about the stratum spinosum layer, it comprises of large irregular polyhedral cells and it is a differentiated form. So this is the first sign of maturation that the basal layer has differentiated into prickle cell layer. And in these layers, the nucleus stain will be less intense in comparison to the basal layer. Basal layer will be hyperchromatic because of its increased division or increased mitotic activity. So these will be large cells with less nuclear intensity and they will have large intercellular spaces and there will be prominent desmosomal junctions. Now moving on to the next layer, that is stratum granulosum. This layer comprises of large flat cells and they will have granules. These granules will be basophilic. So they will give basophilic appearance and these granules are known as keratohyaline granules. So these granules are irregular in shape and they are synthesized by the ribosome. So these cellular organelles will have synthetic activities and these granules will be produced by the ribosome. So when we talk about the component of these granules, the major protein which makes up this granules are filaggrin. Another rich component which is sulfur rich is also there, that is known as loricrin. So in this layer, the nucleus will show signs of degeneration and pycnosis. So in the basal and the spinous layer, nucleus will be more pronounced, whereas in the granulosum and the corneum layer, the nucleus will show degenerative and pycnotic changes. Also, these layer, that is the stratum granulosum, will show lamellar granule, which are known as keratinosome, Odlin bodies, or membrane coating granules. So these Odlin bodies will be found in the stratum granulosum layer and they are rich in glycolipids. So it is a very frequently asked question in Viva, what are Odlin bodies? So Odlin bodies are lamellar granular organelles. They are also known as keratinosomes. They are basically membrane coating granules. So we'll be seeing the granules which will be coating the membrane of the cells. So in the stratum granulosum, there will be flatter, wider cells and nucleus will show some signs of degeneration and pycnosis and there will be basophilic granules in this layer. So coming on to the Odlin bodies, these Odlin bodies are modified lysosomes. So whenever somebody asks what are Odlin bodies, they are known as keratinosomes, they are known as membrane coating granules and they are modified lysosomes. They are rich in phospholipids and they basically form a structure of layers of parallel lamellae. Okay, and they take their origin from Golgi apparatus. So you have to keep in mind they are modified lysosomes and they form parallel lamellae and they will release granules. The superficial layer is the stratum corneum and this surface layer is a keratinized layer. It is also known as cornified layer. The pattern of maturation can be orthokeratinized or parakeratinized. All the organelles including the nuclei and the granules will start disappearing in the stratum corneum. So we won't be seeing the granules and the nuclei in the stratum corneum layer. However, if it is parakeratinized, we'll be able to see pycnotic or the shrunken nuclei. So in this layer, the cells will start dehydrating. They become packed with the filaments. There will be dense packing of the cells and they will assume a flat shape. So there will be hexagonal disc and these cells are known as keratin squames. These squames, by the process of desquamation, are lost and then the cells from the underlying layer will replace these dead cells. So the dead cells will be desquamated and the cells from the basal layer will move on to form the spinous layer. Spinous layer will form the granulosum layer and the granulosum will further differentiate to the corneum layer. So this turnover takes place repeatedly. Also, the keratinized layer in the oral cavity may be composed of 20 layers of squames and it can be thicker also. So when we see the stratum corneum, it is formed by the help of keratinized squames. They are large, they are flat in comparison to the granular cells and there will be no nuclei or shrunken nuclei and there will be no organelles seen in this. When you see the cell surface, the cells are more regular, they are closely adapted, and this close adaptation is attributed to a non-fibrous interfilamentous protein, that is filaggrin. So this close adaptation of the cells is because of the filaggrin protein. So now coming on to the histology of the masticatory mucosa, we'll be discussing gingiva and hard palate today. So when we talk about gingiva, gingiva extends from the dentogingival junction to the alveolar mucosa. The epithelium is stratified squamous in nature, which can be keratinized or non-keratinized. In the gingiva, 75% of gingiva is parakeratinized, 15% is orthokeratinized, 10% is non-keratinized. When we talk about non-keratinized gingiva, it is the cone. Cone is the tent-like space between the facial and the lingual gingiva, and it is covered by non-keratinized epithelium. This is a very frequently asked question in Viva, okay, what is a cone? So you have to remember that gingiva is keratinized except cone, which is non-keratinized. So when we talk about the histology of gingiva, the epithelium can be orthokeratinized or parakeratinized with a stippled surface. So you'll be able to appreciate the structures in the epithelium of the gingiva. It is parakeratinized stratified squamous epithelium with long narrow rattan ridges. Can you appreciate the elongated narrow ridges? Also, there will be deep connective tissue papilla. So if you can make out the features in the histopathology, there will be long narrow rattan ridges. There will be deep connective tissue papilla. There will be layer of parakeratin or orthokeratin, and there will be a spinous layer. So when you see the gingiva, there is no distinct submucosa is there. The epithelium is attached to the underlying periosteum and cementum with the help of these collagen fibers. Also, there will be stippling, which can be appreciated in the healthy gingiva, and this is because of the deep tissue papilla. So this is a histopathological picture for the histology of gingiva, in which you can appreciate the long narrow rattan ridges. Also, there is deep connective tissue pores into the epithelium, because of which there is stippling in the gingiva. Then the surface epithelium will show parakeratinized or orthokeratinized epithelium. And also you can appreciate the thick spinous layer. Whereas in the underlying connective tissue stroma, you can only appreciate the collagen bundles. Moving on to the next keratinized mucosa of the oral cavity is the hard palate. It is tightly fixed to the underlying periosteum. It is immovable. It is pink. It is well keratinized. So the epithelium is keratinized stratified squamous epithelium. When we talk about the histological zones of hard palate, the first zone is the gingival region. Second is the palatine raphe, also known as median area. Third is the anterior lateral area or the fatty zone. Fourth is the posterior lateral area or the glottal zone. So these are the four histological zones of hard palate. Very frequently asked question in the Viva, okay, what are the histological zones of hard palate? Okay, so you have to keep in mind, it is the gingival region, it is the mid-palatine raphe area, it is the anterior lateral fatty zone, posterior lateral glandular zone. When we talk about the histology, in the histology, can you appreciate the keratinized stratified squamous epithelium? There is dense connective tissue stroma. So, in the histology, we'll be seeing the palatine raphe area, the fatty area, and the glandular area. Also, the epithelium is directly adhered to the underlying periosteum. There is no submucosa in between. So when we appreciate the histology of palate, there will be broad retipex, there will be flat epithelial connective tissue interface. In some areas, there will be connective tissue cores into the epithelium. Also, there is the adipose layer, that is the fatty zone of the palate, and there will be dense collagen which connects the epithelium to the underlying periosteum. So there will be parakeratinized stratified squamous epithelium with dense collagen in the underlying stroma. Also, there can be fatty zone or there can be glandular zone. So when we talk about stratified squamous epithelium, we have the basal layer, which shows the mitotic activity or the dividing cell population. Then the spinous layer, in which we can appreciate the proliferation of the cells, followed by the cell migration in the granulosum layer, and the superficial layer, that is the stratum corneum, in which there will be cell loss by the process of desquamation. So in this way, the stratified squamous epithelium strata is formed. So to summarize, we have masticatory mucosa, keratinized stratified squamous epithelium in hard palate and gingiva. Some region of specialized mucosa may also have keratinized epithelium. The epithelium of the masticatory mucosa is inflexible, it is tightly bound, and the interface between the epithelium and the lamina propria will show elongated papillae. So these are the histological features for keratinized mucosa. Also, there are distinguishing features between the keratinized and the non-keratinized epithelium. In the keratinized epithelium, we have basal layer, prickle cell layer, the anulosum layer, and the corneum layer. Whereas in non-keratinized epithelium, we'll be having the basal layer, the prickle cell layer, intermediate cell layer, and the superficial layer. So when you see the histology, we can appreciate that in the keratinized epithelium, there will be the basal layer, which will show cuboidal to columnar cell with hyperchromatic nuclei. In the prickle cell layer, there will be prickle cell with less intensity of the nucleus. Then the granular cell layer, in which the keratohyaline granules can be appreciated with a basophilic tinge, followed by a flat squamous cell, that is the stratum corneum. Whereas in the non-keratinized epithelium, you can appreciate three layers, the basal layer, the intermediate layer formed by the polyhedral cells, then the superficial layer formed by the flat cells. This is the histological presentation of keratinized and the non-keratinized epithelium, in which the keratinized epithelium will have ortho and parakeratinized. In orthokeratinized epithelium, there will be absence of nucleus in the keratinized epithelium. Whereas in the parakeratinized layer, there will be pycnotic or shrunken nuclei. And in the non-keratinized, we can appreciate the basal layer, the prickle cell layer, intermediate layer, and the superficial layer. Thank you.